Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to an event of the New York Abu Dhabi Institute. I am Fabio Piano. I'm the provost of NYU Abu Dhabi, and it's a real pleasure to welcome you all to a very special evening. I also should say that in the context of tonight's lecture, I also hold the directorship of a center in New York called the Center for Genomics and Systems Biology. And in fact, Nikolaus, our speaker tonight, has been one of the first people that we recruited to that center at the very beginning and started a lifelong friendship since then. So tonight, we're going to have a very special treat of both science and music. And it's really amazing that that Nikolaus has agreed to do this, which I think is going to be a really wonderful way to marry these two ideas. So the Nikolaus Rajewsky, I think, is important to tell you a little bit about his background. He's in fact a known pioneer in this area that we call genomics and systems biology. But he's also a very accomplished musician, and he started to study piano at age 6 and continued, in fact, on his musical training, and eventually spent 4 years at the Music Academy in Cologne, where he then continued to study piano, completing his piano artist diploma with Catherine Vickers, and participating in many master classes with great pianists like Leonard Stein and others. He has performed across the world with piano solo recitals, including across Europe, of course, the US, and I saw also he gave a concert in Japan, in Tokyo. But in addition to his musical talent, which is really remarkable, I think it's incredible to talk to you a little bit about Nikolaus Rajewsky as a scientist, because he really is a leader in this area of genomics and systems biology. He's currently a global distinguished professor at NYU. And by the way, this reminds me to tell you that perhaps for tonight's event, unless you have Beethoven as your ringer, maybe it's good if you can turn off your cell phones. But he has been, in fact, an incredible force in this area of genomics and systems biology. And besides his global professorship at NYU, which he's held since the beginning of joining us at NYU, he's also a professor at the MDC and the Charité in systems biology. When he returned to Berlin, where he is mostly now, he founded and now heads one of the most exciting centers in the area of medical systems biology in Europe. And in fact, I think he has really developed a group of people that are really pioneering a lot of the systems that we try to understand in terms of how the genome is really the mechanism for putting together life forms. And so one of the things that I think is going to be very exciting to hear about tonight is, in fact, this big question of how genomics has really helped us understand biology. And I think it's on everybody's mind since the very beginning of the genomics era, which culminated, we could say, when the Human Genome Project, in fact, was unveiled in this really big fanfare of a video conference, in fact, between Europe and the US and Clinton and Blair, basically talking about this as being one of the most exciting and important human accomplishments in this century, that now that we have the genome, what does it really tell us? And how can it really help us? The idea, already from the beginning, was that it could help us in a lot of questions around medicine, a lot of questions around how the organisms, in fact, have come to be on this planet, how life is really dictated by some genetic code that is sitting in each one of our cells. And so it's interesting to now think, how could you explore this question? Well, exploring it with a historical figure as important and enigmatic as Beethoven, I think is going to be an extremely interesting way to see what we can tell from a genome. And thinking of that, putting that together with music is going to be really great. So, In final note, to tell you a little bit about Nikolaus's degrees and awards, which are many, I'll just give you a couple of highlights. Interestingly enough, Nikolaus is actually a trained physics person. His PhD from the University of Cologne was in theoretical physics. He then came to the US and first spent some time at Rutgers University in mathematical physics. then moving to Rockefeller University in New York City, where he really started to move from physics totally to biology. So you can see the amazing breadth of Nikolaus's training. He then joined us at NYU after being at Rockefeller, and as you can see, he's been with the biology department. So he's really moving around all the disciplines. Of the many prizes and highlights of his awards, I think it's really important to mention one, which he got last year, which is in the Leibniz Award, which is the most prestigious research award in Germany. And he was given this for his pioneering work in genomics and systems biology, but I think particularly because he's been working in an area that didn't even exist a few years ago, of learning, in fact, how a new class of regulatory genes that are just made of RNA, and they're called microRNAs or small RNAs, are in fact regulating a lot of the cell activities that are inside our bodies. We had no idea that these things even existed a few years ago, and now with genomics, we know that there's new classes of these genes, and we know that they're in fact incredibly important for things like disease, including cancer, and much of that work is actually done in Nikolaus's lab. So with that, I'd like to help me join in welcoming Nikolaus Rajewsky to Abu Dhabi. Please, Nikolaus.
So welcome, everybody. Good evening. I would like to thank several people. First of all, Fabio, for this very nice introduction. Too long, though. And I would also like to thank Claude Desplan, who is here, also helped in organizing this. And then a number of people who worked, for example, on really getting the piano and everything done in a very, very nice way. So these people are Antoine, Jared, indirectly Pauline, Niels. And I would like to point out that Yuki, one of the students of NYU Abu Dhabi, has kindly agreed to turn pages tonight. And so also thank you. So with this, I would also like to say that tonight's event is not something that I do normally. In fact, this is the very first time I'm doing something like this, like a joint science music session. So it's an adventure, presumably for you, but for sure for me. And in essence, you can ask me, why do I talk about genomics and Beethoven? And I can give you many reasons for that, but I think in the end it boils down that simply I love Beethoven very much. And so that's really in essence why I'm doing this now. But there are interesting scientific and intellectual aspects when asking the question I'm asking here, which is what could modern genomics teach us about Beethoven? And I'll tell you first a little bit about Beethoven's life and his diseases. He not only had one disease, he was really terribly affected by diseases. Then I'll give you a very brief intro into genomics and what it perhaps means to sequence the genome or a human genome and the implications of that when thinking about Beethoven as a person. I'll also point out some of the ongoing directions which are ongoing in various places on this planet which go towards personalized medicine, but this will be brief. And I'll spend then some time on explaining a little bit about the pieces I'm going to play, because I chose pieces which are maybe not so familiar to everybody. They belong to his late period. He wrote them when he was 50 years and older. The first piece, the piano sonata, number 30, is his last third sonata composed. And he composed it when he was almost deaf. Maybe I forgot to say that his major disease was deafness. I mean, this is very famous, right? And the second piece, the so-called Diabelli variations, are actually the last major work he wrote for piano. And at this point, he was completely deaf. I'll not play everything. I'll play a selection of them, also depending on time. I don't know how it will go. I'll also try to take some questions in the end. But after I introduce these pieces, I'll sit down at the piano and play them, first the sonata and then the Diabelli variations. Okay, so this is the birthplace of Beethoven. It is located in Bonn, which is very near to my hometown, Cologne. And in fact, the house and actually the room where he was born are completely conserved. So you can go there and have a look. And I put here a photograph of the current Beethoven house, as it is called, in Bonn. And there you see here in the back a picture, a drawing that was made of the Beethoven house 100 years ago. And you can perhaps see that this is almost identical. In fact, here under, in this tiny roof room, this is where Beethoven was born, 770. So he's dead now for almost 190 years. He got 57 years. In case you want to read literature, there are, of course, hundreds of books written about Beethoven. And I put here Jan Kayer's a relatively new Beethoven book, which I like very much because you can read it in one go. It is nevertheless comprehensive and thorough. And I think it's, it has many interesting aspects which had not been so much discussed before. The Solomon Beethoven is a classic. It is certain parts are perhaps outdated, but it's a classic about Beethoven. Then you can freely from the web download Beethoven's letters, so you can see what he wrote, the correspondence he had. And then I need to mention his conversation booklets. So what are these? So as I said, Beethoven became deaf. And so how could he converse with people? He did this by presenting to them little books where they could write down what they wanted to ask him. And then he would answer. He was very impatient, so he would usually guess immediately what they were about to ask. So when you look at these conversation books, they're more like SMS documents. And they usually go only in one way, but they're yet very informative. And then when it comes to music, I guess most of you have heard some Beethoven, but most of his pieces are actually rarely played. And in fact, the late string quartets, which he wrote in the last years of his life, are, in my opinion, not only my opinion, really a life-altering experience when you listen to them. And even if, so after tonight's lecture, if you didn't really understand what I was trying to say and you didn't really like my piano playing, but one thing you can perhaps do, you can consider doing, go and listen to the late string quartets. You can do this on YouTube, you can do this anywhere you want. I'm just saying, when I did this as a young man, my life changed, so it was different afterwards. I'm pointing out here one example, which is also very famous, and it contains a piece of music, The Great Fugue, composed 2 years before he died, almost never played, but considered to be music written for the next hundreds of years. That's also how Beethoven himself saw himself. He was aware of what he was doing. Okay, you can also go to Vienna, where Beethoven lived most of his life. And you can actually see the house or houses where he lived. So this is one of the houses. This is actually pictures I took last year. You can walk in and people live in this house as I did 150 years ago. And you can see that he lived several times in this house in various apartments. So a lot of his life and what he did is still very much there. You can go and explore it. So this is a life mask of Beethoven. This is not a death mask. This is taken when he was 42 years old. And so the artists in those days, he put some substance on his face. He had to breathe through straws and close his eyes. And then the idea was that this would become hard and would become a mask. Beethoven was, however, he freaked out. And after some time, he took the substance from his face and threw it on the floor and ran out of the room. And so the thing broke into several pieces, but it was already hard enough so that the artist could put it together. So this is why you see here these strange scars, so to speak. This is a drawing which was done 6 years later. There are many drawings, but I think you get an idea how he looked like. And in fact, this is a picture which I think is really remarkable. It's done by an artist of the Beethoven Society who merged several drawings and the photograph of the life mask. So I think if you look at this, you would presumably recognize him on the streets of Vienna if you were to walk there 190 years ago. So Beethoven started to notice a horrible sound in his ears and tinnitus when he was in his middle 20s. And he then noticed that his hearing declined. And this, of course, was for him as a making his life in Vienna as a pianist, as an active pianist, was a catastrophe, right? So it's he knew that he was about to lose his way to make his living, because you cannot be a performing artist when you don't hear. And so he decided that he had two choices, one suicide and the other to concentrate on his life as a composer. And he wrote in 1802 these three pages basically to himself. It's a letter to his brothers, but he never sent them. They're really meant for himself, like your psychotherapist tells you perhaps to write letters to yourself so that you can find out or get some clarity of what's going on. And so in these letters, he basically explained that he had made the decision to grab fate by the throat, that's how he put it, and to really concentrate on his life as a composer and to live with the fact that he couldn't really talk to other people anymore, and he had to give up his active career as a pianist. So he also wrote something which I think is interesting in our context here. He was desperate about his deafness. And he had asked countless doctors to help him, but nobody knew that he had a rare condition, so nobody knew what was wrong with him, and nobody could help him. And he was so desperate about this that he said in this, that he writes in here, that as soon as I'm dead, and if his current doctor, Professor Schmidt, is still alive, he asked to describe his illness, right, for people to find out and give an account so that there's some reconciliation. So somehow Beethoven, I think, would be happy if people would find out what was wrong with him, what was really his disease. So his disease is not only deafness. He actually suffered from chronic abdominal pain from a teenager until his death. He was bleeding frequently from his nose and his ears. And he had very rapid changes of feeling well or feeling ill. In the end, he died. The cause of death was most likely a liver cirrhosis. He also liked to drink. So you see, diseases are a complex matter. It's not so simple. So he didn't die from his deafness. He died from a liver cirrhosis. And proposed causes for the hearing and all of these symptoms are actually many, and I'm just listing some here. You see basically the despair of doctors here also in trying to diagnose him. Typhus, autoimmune disorders, lead poisoning, syphilis, alcoholism, hepatitis, Whipple's disease, and so on. So you can easily assemble a meter of a bookshelf with literature about maybe causes of his illnesses. Most, I think, one of the major theories is that he got bitten by an infected flea bug in Berlin, of all places, and got typhus. And that sometimes has these kinds of symptoms he had. But that's just one theory. I would also like to say when the title of the lecture, Genomics, What Can We Learn About Beethoven, is maybe not only about his talking about his diseases, but also about his quote-unquote ability, certainly, you know, I just listed some of them basically randomly, right? This is trivial. But is there any way you could ask to, when you nowadays sequence a human being, can you learn something about these abilities? It's certainly a question I think that many of you are asking or maybe asking when you hear about the ability of looking into the genome of human beings. And I'll just discuss absolute pitch. I'll not discuss the others, but because they're impossible to address nowadays. So I'll now tell you a little bit about genomics and human DNA. So first of all, DNA is contained in almost all cells of your body, and it encodes the hereditary material. So what you get from mom and dad is stored in your DNA. You have in your cells almost the exact same copy of DNA. And the DNA is assembled in chromosomes. This is something that you may know. But if you really look down in detail, it is a sequence of four letters, A, C, G, T, which stand for certain chemical elements that are in one linear arrangement, in a huge linear arrangement, actually in a sequence of 3 billion ACGTs. And I'll refer to this to these 3 billion letters in sequence as the genome. Now, what is happening is that this DNA is being encodes proteins. For humans, there are 20,000 possible proteins to make. That's our repertoire. And the DNA basically dictates which proteins are being synthesized in what kind of condition. And in other words, DNA gives instructions to make proteins which form a human cell. So the cells in your body are made of proteins, and a liver cell, a kidney cell, a brain cell, they're all different, and yet they are produced by the same set of instructions. That's a big mystery, and my colleagues like Claude Desplan or Fabio are people working on these kinds of questions which go into developmental genetics. Cells altogether form a human being, so you can say, in essence, that the DNA makes a human being, gives the instructions to make each of us in an individual way. We have all different DNA. So what is now possible is to sequence genomes. In other words, to determine the precise sequence of these 3 billion letters, in which exact way are the ACGTs ordered in your DNA. And this is due to big advances in technology. So roughly 10 years ago, when the first human genome was deciphered, it took 15 years, it was $1 billion, and it was an effort of a worldwide team. Nowadays, you can do it in 10 days on a desktop machine, and for a cost of maybe $50,000 or so. And in the future, I just wrote down something basically ad gusto, 1 hour for 1,000, but it might also be minutes for cents, I don't know. This technology is advancing at exponential pace. So clearly, the technology makes it possible for all of us to be sequenced, the DNA to be sequenced. So this is something that has, of course, major implications. And just to maybe give you an example of real life, in my institute where I work at the MDC in Berlin, we have roughly 5 of these desktop machines I was talking about. They cost altogether 2.5 million euros, so not that much. And since 2009, we sequenced on our machines altogether about 1,000 human genomes, if you just count the nucleotides that we sequenced. So that's quite a bit if you think about it. That's just 5 machines in a couple of years. And this is, you see that the number of samples and the sequencing output is continuously growing. And that's, I think, not just for us, that's for everybody. So first question, is it possible to sequence Beethoven's genome? And after all, the guy is 190 years dead. So there is hair preserved from Beethoven. And in fact, this hair, Beethoven had lots of hair. And when he died, all his friends came to say goodbye on his deathbed, well, after he was dead. And as a souvenir, many of them cut off a lock of hair. In fact, he was bald when he was buried. So there are many of these hair locks in private possession, but also many over time made it into the collection of museums. So the museum in Bonn, the museum in Vienna, they have some amounts of hair at their disposal. Some of them you can even see in the museum. You can see it. And actually, there was a book in 2000, it was actually a bestseller in the US, The History of Just One Beethoven Hair Lock, written by Russell Martin. It's a story of a lock of hair that got during Nazi Germany on a very adventurous way out of Germany to the US and is now in a private museum and research institute for Beethoven in California. So there are these locks of hair. Next question is, okay, can you actually, does it help you? Can you extract DNA from human hair? And normally the answer is that you can only extract DNA if you have the follicle, so if you have the root of the hair from inside the scalp, which is usually not the case, presumably, with this hair because it was just cut with scissors. And so you would think it might not be possible because the hair itself is just keratin growing out and the cell itself is underneath in the skull, in the scalp. But it turns out that this is not quite true. In fact, this is an example from a science paper where they managed to take a lock of hair from an aboriginal man, roughly 100 years dead, and they managed to extract nuclear DNA and sequence it and actually get the entire genome of this aborigine. This was an interesting science paper, what did they actually do with this information? They looked at the ancestors of this aborigine, and they could show that the present-day Aboriginal Australians most likely descend from the earliest humans to occupy Australia, likely representing one of the oldest continuous population outside Africa. So the important point is that the Aborigines were apparently there out of Africa, but not mixing with Europeans until now, of course. So that's also something I'm going to go a little bit into this, that you can do with DNA. You can trace the ancestry, because after all, in the DNA, there are your genes. You get them from your mom and dad, and of course, then from the ancestors of your mom and dad, and so on. So you can reconstruct the history where you come from, in principle. So now that we have learned that it should be, in principle, possible to sequence Beethoven's DNA, what could we actually learn? First question is, of course, that's more or less a triviality, that you don't need to really sequence. You can do this with older methods looking at DNA. Did Beethoven maybe have progeny of sorts or relatives that are still alive nowadays? And you presumably have not heard that he had children. That's also, of course, not known. But there's a Beethoven was a great lover of actually a number of women. And he was very easy, apparently, to get in love. He was a very passionate man. And there's a very, very famous letter, which you can also see in the internet. It's a so-called letter to the, what he called, immortal beloved. The identity of this woman to which this letter is written is not conclusively proven, although hundreds of people have tried to find out. I'll tell you a little bit about this. But just to say that this letter is dated Monday night, July 6th, but it doesn't tell you the year. So what people boiled it down to are two suspects, Anthony Brentano and Josefina Brunswick, born in Brunswick and later became Stackelberg, both from nobility. That's important. And so there's a whole detective story behind that because people looked at the police records to find out where they stayed on that July night. And you can learn that it must have been 812 from studying the paper on which the letter was written and so on. You can read this yourself. It's really a fun little detective story. But these two females presumably are the main suspects. And what is somewhat a crazy coincidence is that both of them gave birth more or less roughly, well, more or less precisely 9 months later. one Brentano to Carl Josef, and Josephine to a daughter called Minona. And so people have suspected that maybe these were actually one of them, or both even, who knows, were children of Beethoven. Actually, there's a picture of Minona, so this might be actually some relative of Beethoven. But my point here is that the graves of these people are still there. They're in Vienna, so one could get DNA from their bones, and it would be a very simple thing to find out if they were children or not. But this is really just a more trivial example. I just wanted to tell you the story. I also wanted to point out that Beethoven was, it was a disaster for Beethoven, this last meeting in 812 when the letter was written, because he broke up with this woman, most likely because she was from nobility and had children from a previous marriage. And in those days, if he would have married her, she would have lost her status as a noble woman, and she would have lost authority over her children. And so this presumably was the reason why Beethoven then, until the rest of his life, was very unhappy and stayed alone. It was a tragedy for him. Okay, now ancestry of Beethoven. Beethoven, it's just an amusing note perhaps, Beethoven was of dark complexion. He was always called as a young man the Spaniard, that was his nickname, and people always suspected there was something funny with his ancestry. So there are also books written about this. So what could we learn about the ancestry of Beethoven? Well, genes mirror the geography within Europe. Okay, also within the United States or worldwide. This is just a paper that was published 5 years ago. And in essence, what these people did, sorry for the quality, but that's how it is. They picked people from Europe, and they they quantified the sequence of the DNA in various places, and they computed the similarity between people based on their DNA sequence. And now you can plot the similarity in two axes. This is principal component analysis for the mathematicians. And if you do this, so each dot is one human being, the DNA from one human being, you see that some people are close to each other, closer than to others. And this is some kind of pattern. If you look at this pattern, you actually see that it reflects precisely the European map. And in fact, you can use it obviously to predict where the ancestry of a person is from. And they gave you this picture about prediction accuracy. So for example, if you are in Poland, you can nail the precise location of your ancestors to about 400 kilometers or less with a probability of 80%. So it's not so bad. But of course, there are also lots of complications here. This is a vastly simplified picture. And people mix and travel and so on. Things are becoming much more complicated. But on the other hand, this was done with old technology. Nowadays, with sequencing DNA, you get much more information, much finer picture of that. And this is really there are now various projects going on. This is from the National Geographic. It's called the Genographic Project. It's public. You can participate if you want. You just need to send in a DNA sample. You can do this yourself by going to the pharmacy, buying for $100 a little DNA kit. You swap your mouth and you send it in. And so you can participate. There are now 500,000 people actually participating in over 140 countries. And what they do is they look at your DNA, look at parts of the sequence, many parts, and then they compute which mixture of DNA, when looked at the world map, best explains your DNA. So they give you a mixture model of basically how your DNA is composed. Now, I wrote here something on top. I just couldn't resist. You see, alle Menschen werden Brüder. That's a famous part of a song in Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. It's a quote from Schiller, and the translation is something like, all people shall be brothers. Beethoven very much believed in that people are equal, and he was fighting against born nobility in many ways in his life, and he was very much into international thoughts. I could go on about this, but I thought this is maybe nice to say, because you see, this project is really about something that is common to all of us, which is to all human beings, which is the history of their DNA, right? It's something that unites each and every human being on this planet. And so what you can do is you can send in your DNA, and they tell you this, your ancestry. By the way, do you know this is part of the Ode of Joy, right? So I said it, Ninth Symphony. It's presumably the most famous melody ever that exists nowadays. And it's typical for Beethoven that presumably if you just play five notes, you will know the melody, even if you don't know this. If you just play this. I don't even need to continue, right? You know. And you see that I think it's also very typical for Beethoven's music. I just played four notes, right? And you know, of the, I don't know, thousands of pieces you have listened to, you immediately know what this is. Okay, so I would also like to point out that for the maybe more experts of this, if you think, okay, so this is anonymous, and you can also tell them that you get information about possible relatives that are very close in DNA to you. But you should be aware that even if this is anonymous, if the sequence is available on the internet, there are ways to at least sometimes find out even the name of the person who donated the DNA, at least for males, because on the male chromosome, which only runs in males, there's a strong correlation between the surname and certain markers. And people have published here in this interesting science paper, they have gone through the public records and they have identified the names of 50 people that anonymously donated their DNA for science. So, okay. So understanding Beethoven's musical abilities from his DNA, that's when we start with this. Let's consider a very simple ability, which is absolute pitch. Absolute pitch is the ability, if I play a note on the piano, that you know which key, basically, I pressed, okay? It's not relative, so it's absolute here. You know, you recognize the frequency. So first of all, what you learn from this paper here is that if you ask people to recognize a sinus tone, a pure frequency, people basically cannot do it, or they can do it. There's very little gray zone. I think it is clear that absolute pitch is at least in part in your DNA, because it is known that a sibling of a person with absolute pitch is 15 times more likely to have absolute pitch than a sibling of a person without absolute pitch, right? So there's something about absolute pitch that runs in families. The story is, by the way, much more complicated, and we can talk about it later. I don't have the time to really go into this, but already this is a complex topic. Nevertheless, there's a genetic component to this. And here's a paper now from recent years where they tried to find the locations in the DNA which are linked to the ability to have absolute pitch. And I'm not going to read this to you, but basically the upshot is that they found some weak correlations with multiple parts in the human genome. So it's not one gene that is for absolute pitch. You have this version or you don't. But it's a complex trait. Apparently, several genes are participating in this, so it's not easy to nail this. So, in fact, if you would sequence Beethoven, it would be impossible nowadays to say if he had absolute pitch or not. Okay. So then I thought, okay, so it's really not worth to go into other even more complex traits like, I don't know, creativity or willpower, all of this. I think this is just completely crazy to think that we can read this off DNA nowadays. But let's turn towards diseases. And I'll just give you an example of a disease where you have the power to learn something from the DNA sequence. And this is Huntington's disease, a terrible neurological disease. And in fact, all patients with Huntington, they have a repeat expansion of three letters from these four letters in the genome within one certain locus, one gene in this huge 3 billion sea of letters, okay? So it's really a remarkable thing. So you can really say there's a one-to-one correspondence between this one tiny bit of DNA and the and having or not having Huntington's disease. And you can even predict, or there's a correlation that you can predict from the DNA, the age at which this disease will kick in. Okay? So that's an extreme example of a disease which you can link to the genotype, to the DNA. But it turns out that for cancer or diabetes or Alzheimer or any many other diseases, this is just not the case. It's much more complex. And there are many regions on the DNA which are involved in these diseases. And why is that really? So, well, one reason is, and I'll just, maybe this is more for the experts, but just to say that what genes make, what is encoded in the DNA, the proteins, they all talk to each other. They form regulatory networks, not all of them, but many of them talk to each other. They form so-called regulatory networks. So one protein can tell another one to be active, or it can tell another one that it should be not active. It's like a discussion of politicians for really making a decision. So the decision about, let's say, having a complex or many of the diseases we have is a result of a complex discussion and cannot be linked to just one locus. That's normally the case. Nevertheless, people are, of course, now trying to find out, to get into this interplay of genes. There are massive efforts, and I would just like to say that there are also advances. For example, this is a story of a doctor who got leukemia. Actually, he's also doing research on leukemia. And he absurdly as well, tragically, he also got leukemia himself. His colleagues decided to sequence, actually not DNA, but also RNA from his cells, as I could look at the activity of genes by this, but it was really a sequencing effort. And what they found, so this guy went classical chemotherapy, the cancer went down, but then came back, and then he was told that he has almost no time to live anymore. When it comes back at this point, with this kind of leukemia he had, the prognosis is devastating. So his colleagues put together money, they sequenced his RNA, and they found that one of his genes was completely over the roof, active. And they found that there's a cancer drug against liver cancer, it's never used against leukemia, that targets this particular gene product. And they then put together their money to buy the medicine for him. And so until now, this man doesn't have any symptoms of cancer anymore. So that's a success story. That's one success story. There are, of course, many failures, and I don't think that you can now cure cancer, but clearly things are moving are progressing, and so this is not unnoticed by also politicians, and they now give a lot of money into this kind of research. I'm starting with Berlin, where I am, where now 340 million euros are invested in this kind of science, medical science, just for the next 5 years. There are articles in journals which you can read about. For example, one which is entitled Poor But Smart, that's for Berlin, right? Berlin is poor, but the mayor said poor but sexy, but this journal says poor but smart. So, but also New York is doing it. They now have a genome center, which is a joint effort of 11 academic and medical institutions. There's a huge amount of money also going into this. Okay. I'll maybe skip this because, of course, I'm spending more time maybe than I should. Just very briefly, for maybe more the experts, there were two very interesting papers coming out recently where people show that it is possible to, in a targeted way, change DNA at various locations simultaneously in human cells. And so this is multiplexed gene targeting. I think that's a very interesting new technology that can maybe also help to explore the interplay between different genes. So in summary, what could we learn from sequencing Beethoven's DNA? We could certainly learn something about his ancestry and maybe his progeny or relatives. I think this point is clear. I think we could learn nothing about his musical abilities. Okay? I think we could learn risk factors for diseases. You can also send your DNA to companies which tell you risk factors for diabetes or certain cancers and so on. But these are just relatively small numbers. So 5%, 3%, 1% increased risk for this or that. That's maybe not so exciting. And also there's presumably we can learn little or nothing about his deafness. It could be that he had a rare disease which affects hearing. There is progressive hearing loss as a genetic rare disease. Actually, there's a microRNA involved in that. That's one only case where microRNA has been proven to be involved in a causative way in a human disease. But this is unlikely. I think it's more likely that it was typhus or other things. This is my personal opinion. But in summary, I would like to express my opinion that I think his DNA is still, I think, would be much more interesting than looking at a dead lock of hairs in some museum. And I think it's clear that research is moving along with a lot of effort and support in many places, and there's a lot to be learned, maybe not in the next 5 years, but let's say in the next 100 years about deciphering, understanding more about such a human being from DNA. Okay, now that we have learned that basically what you learn by sequencing potentially is DNA is limited, let's say, I think much more you can learn by listening to his music. So we come now to the second part of this lecture, which is about really his music. And I'll play this sonata, but I wanted to discuss it very briefly. There's the third last sonata. It's the first sonata of his so-called late style. So he was 50 years old when he composed it. This is actually the beginning of the sonata in the original handwriting. Not very maybe easy to read, but Beethoven used to say, "I don't have the time for writing nicely." And one of the first public performers was actually Liszt, Franz Liszt, famous pianist. And what is typical for his late style was using forms from old ancient music, from the Baroque, from Bach, from church music. Then also extreme contrast in dynamics, in speed, or in tone range, and also in the harmonics. And then a obsession about breaking things down into smaller and smaller units, for example, in terms of rhythm. I'll give you examples for this. So obsessive details, extremism, old forms, using old forms to create something new. That's the characteristics of his late style. And so this is sonata, the beginning. And what you can see here, just by graphically looking at it, even if you don't know how to read music, you see here that it looks similar, and then there's a break, right? And then it looks very different. And this is also how it sounds. So there's a more fluent movement here, and then there's adagio espressivo, so slow and very espressive. And that is using the technique of a recitativo from operas and music composed much earlier that he's using here. You can also see that he's obsessed about the precision of notation and the details. If you look at here, this is forte, loud, piano, soft, crescendo, moving forward to a forte, crescendo again, piano, crescendo, forte, crescendo, piano, forte, diminuendo, espressivo, crescendo. There are all kinds of additional marks here which I don't have time to go into. Also, the pedaling is prescribed. It's really an obsession about getting into more and more detail and really getting into the smallest controllable units. I should also say that if you play the beginning of this sonata, you would not recognize, presumably, that it can be also heard as a chorale. But that's maybe where this comes from, and it's just transformed in a way that you wouldn't maybe directly recognize this. Next example for rhythmic breakdown. This is from the last movement of this sonata. You see here that it starts with a B, which is repeated 6 times. There's a melody interspersed. But you see that this B is then broken into double tempo after 2 bars. Okay? 1 note, 2 notes repeated in the same unit of time. Then 3 units, the B. Then 6. Then 8. And then the only thing that can come after that is a trill. Okay? And so this trill stays on the B for 1.5 more pages. Can you imagine that? Okay. That's a little bit about the sonata. Then I'm going to play parts of the Diabelli variations, which is, as I said, the last piece he composed, major piece for piano. Actually, he didn't call this himself variations. He called it Veränderung, or transformations. And this piece has a very interesting history. So there was a publisher and composer named Diabelli. He had a very good business idea. He thought, I'll give a theme to the 32 leading composers in Vienna, and I'll ask each one of them to write one variation. I'll collect those, and I'll sell them as a compendium of 32 variations, and everybody will want to buy them because it's written by all the famous composers in Vienna. So he also asked Beethoven to make a contribution of one variation to this. Beethoven got very upset because he felt that he's the only composer in Vienna. And he wrote back that he would not contribute one, he would actually contribute not 32, but 33. So at this point, he was completely deaf. It's dedicated to Antony Brentano, which maybe you recognize as one of the candidates for the immortal beloved. And actually, the sonata is dedicated to her daughter. Okay. It's rarely played. It takes 60 minutes to go through the entire piece. And long thought, it was long thought to not be playable. And he arrived at a new technique. He uses only a tiny fraction of the theme to create completely new music. So it's not as people used to take a melody and change it in certain ways to give it a new details, but he takes a certain detail from the melody and he creates something completely new. And it also contains, so I'll give you an example of this, but I also like to say that the variations contain homage to other composers, so not the living composers in Vienna, but the composer, the only one that Beethoven thought were really worthwhile talking about. And these were, next to him, of course, Handel, Mozart, Bach, okay? Then the entire piece also has a lot of humor. You will hear that, hopefully. It's sarcastic, often cynical. And so he also has a cynical piece devoted to the study writers of those days who would write finger lessons. And I think also he wrote not only about homage to dead composers, but also, I think, to future composers, which didn't exist at that time. I think he was just looking very far into the future. And so the theme is the waltz by Diabelli. So it's a waltz. So it's it's a 1-2-3, 1-2-3 waltz. Again, it's transformations. And what I'll just say is the first variation then is here I come. That's how I see it. It's the here I come, meaning Beethoven. It's written as a march and maestoso, of course, majesty, right? So that's himself. And you see, you'll hear that's a very striking rhythm that is has a lot of power and is very marching. Then about transformation, and also his habit in later years to completely, to have all the voices, all the writing in independent voices called polyphony. This is maybe a nice example. So I should explain this. So the waltz, the theme goes like this. if you look at this piece. So that's only taking the first three, four notes from the theme, and then writing something completely new. He also invented deletions. So he takes a theme and simply deletes parts. Okay. And then, of course, after that comes a variation which is completely spaced out. In so there's not a single space here. So it's, again, extremism. You go from this to something that has the exact opposite in character. Dedication to Mozart, there's a variation which is based on a theme of an opera from Don Giovanni, one of his operas. Actually, it's from an aria by Leporello, the servant of Don Giovanni, saying that he has to work day and night for his master. And so this is about irony that Beethoven has to work day and night here to finish these things. And the next one is for the piano exercise writers. So you see, you can maybe see this. There's a Bach, so there's a fuga here. And into the future, there's this Sphinx-like variation, which you can maybe already see is hard to describe. Right? It's empty notes from beginning to end. And you'll see that it has very interesting harmonics, which people in his day thought that he has lost his mind. The second one is about, I think, destruction. You can maybe think about Prokofiev. Actually, I photographed this from the original handwriting of Beethoven. This is his writing. And you see here, maybe hopefully you can see it, these white spots on the paper. These are actually scratch marks. He got very excited when he composes, apparently. But then he made mistakes, and he got so upset about his mistakes that he took a knife and scratched out the wrong parts. So it looks then like this. You can also see that every second note is a sforzando, an impact. So that's maybe you can think nowadays about Prokofiev or others who go in this who went into this direction. And there's of course a final homage to the Goldberg variations. This big variation, which is you'll maybe hear, is in parallel to some pieces written by Bach in his famous 32 Goldberg variations. I'll stop here. And now maybe take 2 minutes of a tiny break. And then I think I have left, not so bad, exactly 45 minutes, 40 minutes or so. Maybe 30 minutes so we can take some questions. I'll just see how it goes. But maybe we can take a 2 minute break, not more. And we'll start the program here. Okay? Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So you use some informatics to be able to study the pattern of DNA to try to understand the grammar of DNA. We do understand music much better. We know the grammar of music. But do you think that you can use the same algorithm we use for DNA to try to understand more about the music, what genius is about?
So on a technical level, just using the same or similar mathematics, this is actually true. So for example, if you want to identify music automatically, right? So you play some music and you want the computer to identify which music is actually being played. So you have to match this one thing that you hear to, I don't know, millions of records. This is a pattern similarity thing, and the mathematics of this is, for example, similar to what's used in genome analysis. But presumably, as it is often the case, both camps could learn from each other.
Yeah, you mentioned that it was difficult to interpret musical ability from the genome, which is probably realistic, perhaps a bit disappointing. Can you conceive of a day where the complex interactions of the genes may be understood?
Oh, yeah. I think for absolute pitch, there ought to be a way to understand more about it, and there are just very few people working on it. I mean, who would fund this kind of research, right? I mean, so as far as I can see, there's only one team in California really working on this, linking this to genetics. So that's one paper I was showing, and that's also, I think then what I read is on their webpage is that they're now using really sequencing to get much more depth of and more samples to get much more power of analysis. What they published, they had only a few samples, and they did a very shallow characterization of the genomes of the people with absolute pitch versus people without absolute pitch. So I think there is much more to come, and so looking forward to that.
Beethoven's last sonata also ends with a last movement of variations. The Diabelli variations that you played today are also his last, you know, major piano work. Is this a coincidence, or do you think he had a certain fascination with theme and variations?
No, this is something that is typical for his late style. So he discovered that more and more as a form where he felt he could freely express himself, it seems. There are also, by the way, some very interesting similarities in motifs, in musical motifs, between his last piano sonata, the second and last movement, and the Diabelli variations.
Back to the science. Where did the scientists that found the DNA in the hair of the Aboriginal person, where did they find the DNA in the hair with an absence of all cells?
Well, that's a good question, and I just I also don't have an answer for this. So the person who developed the protocol to extract DNA from hair, he just spent many years developing a protocol that was sensitive enough to detect trace amounts of genomic nuclear DNA in the hair body. I talked to him, and he also doesn't really know where this comes from, but he detects it. And actually, I think the Aborigine case is a very clear case that this is working, because they found simply no... You know, you're always worried about contamination in this business, right? But this was done by European scientists and collected by European people, and they found no... I mean, the Aboriginal DNA was completely unmixtured with European DNA, right? That was in the abstract. I didn't quote that. But so I think it's a nice case of showing that this is possible. I don't know where the DNA comes from. But hair is also, if you then look into the details, everything turns out to be more complicated than you thought.
What can you tell about Beethoven from his music?
And if I only had his music, then what?
Yeah, what can you tell about Beethoven? Because we're trying
as a person.
As a person, and about his character, about his ancestry, about his familiar environment.
I don't know. I mean, that's an interesting question. I mean, usually, artists want to be measured by their works, and they want to be understood by what they do. And I think they're usually against these kinds of, that you try to guess what they are as human beings from, you know, this is usually not really the topic for them. So personally, I think, and maybe that's also some kind of a closing statement for this too long event, that I think the best way to understand Beethoven or to have fun with Beethoven is really to listen to his music. Thank you very much.